guy, Shanti Phillips here with my brand new DVD Blu-ray Tuesday shopping video today. Thinking about today, see what things came out, see what things are on sale today. And yes, I know I'm wearing a very different hat. I'm wearing this hat that I got, you know, sent to promote the movie Ma, which comes out to theaters this Friday. So I'm probably gonna go around today and wear this hat and everywhere I go. It's a very weird hat. I'm sure I'll get some interesting looks, but I thought it'd be something really different to wear for the video today. But today, new release-wise, like the big things that come out, there aren't a ton of big things, like the movie Greta comes out, you know, big things that will be in stores. Greta releases today, as well as Vigilante. There's a couple other things as well. Well, also at the end of this video is going to be a whole bunch of brand new DVD and Blu-ray reviews, some things I received to review and talk about for you guys, some really, really cool stuff. And as always too, let me know in the comments below, you know, what you guys thought of the new DVDs and Blu-rays that are reviewed at the end of this video, you know, if you guys have seen any of them, also if you guys plan on picking any of them up. But anyway though guys, let's get going and see what we can find today.
Into Target we go.
And one thing I want to let you guys know is right before the reviews at the end of this video, I have a really, really cool announcement about a brand new movie that I'm going to be appearing in. I'll be talking about it in detail, so definitely, definitely, definitely stay tuned for that right before the reviews at the end of this video.
But they actually do have this stuff out over here, but it looks like they only have the DVD of Greta. That one's $17.98 for that. This one I really like. This is from the director of The Crying Game. Hopefully they have the Blu-ray of that one at Walmart or Best Buy. Other than that, like I said, the Living Wild film that she stars in, A Vigilante, came out. That one's $16.99 for that one. But all the other stuff over here is all the same stuff from last week and everything. I'll look over here though and see if there's anything else different. Yeah, it looks like all the same things here. No, no, this is one of the things that came out. I'm gonna talk about this one at the end of this video. South Park, the complete 22nd season here. That one's $24.99 for that. This one also came out on Blu-ray. I'll see if there's anything else here, but I don't think that there will be. Yeah, and all these classic quotes ones, the quotes packaging ones, these ones all seem to be gone. But yeah, doesn't look like anything else over here. Let's see though if there's anything over here in the kids section that's new. Pretty sure as well all these ones were the same things here from last week as well, but hopefully, you know, fingers crossed that they will have the Blu-ray of Greta at Walmart. Into Walmart we go. And in here today though, luckily enough, I'm seeing a Greta down here. It's $19.96 for that. This is actually a good price for this because I think it's like more money everywhere else when I was looking. If they did have it in store, like at Best Buy, I think it was like $22.99 on there when I was looking online. But it said they only had one copy, so I was kind of worried. So luckily enough, they do have that one here. Other than that though, this is all the stuff from last week, like the How to Train Your Dragon. Those came out last Tuesday, and The Upside and Run the Race. They do have a Vigilante here as well, and that one's $17.96 for that one on Blu-ray, and then $12.96 for that one on DVD. But I think this is one of the other ones that released today, Outlander, the complete fourth season of that one, and that one's $29.96. I only saw a little bit of the first season of that, and then they do have Greta here though on DVD for $14.96, and then the Steven Seagal film, General Commander, that one released, and that one's $12.96 here. But like I said, other than that though, not seeing anything else different because Drunk Parents was last week. Same with Isn't It Romantic?
Yeah, so I ended up getting the Greta one in there for $19.99. Really glad they had this one in there, but I really like this movie. It's like Chloe Grace's character ends up finding this pocketbook on the subway and goes and brings it back to the owner's house, and the woman is like really weird and obsessive, and it's like this whole strange thing going on. But really, really like this one a lot. If you guys have not seen this one, highly recommend you guys check this one out.
Into the Valley Thrift Store we go. And it's been maybe about a month or so since I was last in here, so hopefully I come across some interesting stuff in here. Let's see though. I definitely see a lot of stuff in the bottom. That's always a good sign when there's a bunch of stuff down here in the bottom to look through. Like I said, it's been maybe a month or so since I've been in here, so we'll see, you know, what's in here. It's always though in this area, which is like the shoe kingdom. There's like so many shoes, I can't even believe it, but we'll go through all this and see what we can come across.
Yep.
This is a movie, I always really like this movie. I know this is like such a goofy movie, and I know it's like one of those movies that's like a bad but funny movie that I don't know why. It's just, I wish Eddie Murphy would do another movie like this again when he plays like these crazy characters and makeup and stuff. I always really love that stuff he does. Even though this one was no way near as good as The Night Professor and The Clumps, I still really did like that. And like I said, I'm gonna go through all this and see. And I have found a couple out-of-print things here in the past. Some weird, like, travel vlog Italy thing. But I have found a couple out-of-print things in here in the past. Nothing, like, absolutely amazing. Sometimes, too, I end up, like, missing really, like, stuff. I end up, like, totally passing over some really obscure things in here. Everything in here, though, is $1.99, and usually, like, the Disney things are a little more money. I think the Blu-rays are, I think the Blu-rays are $1.99 as well. The CDs are, like, a dollar. But CDs, though, I never really know what I'm looking for, like, with the out-of-print or obscure stuff. We'll just keep looking through, and I'll show you guys if I come across anything different. I don't know if you guys remember this. This is one of those really weird releases. They like, I think they were trying to do this like when this first came out, and it never caught on when they were putting like the DVD and the CD on it, and like one side of it was the DVD and then the other side was the CD. It was a really weird thing that they did. This is like one of the only releases that I ever remember releasing like this. And this is like one of those sequels. I remember thinking it was kind of okay. This one's never gotten, though, a Blu-ray release or anything. This is the only, never was reissued or anything. This is like the only time they ever released it was this DVD CD combo one. But yeah, let me know if you guys remember this. But, and if you remember any other releases, they were like that, a flipper disc where it was a CD on the other side. But as far as I can remember, that's one of the only ones I remember that was like that.
And this past weekend, I saw a couple of different films. The first one I saw was the film Book Smart, which is directed by Olivia Wilde, which is one I feel like it's too bad that it didn't, you know, do better at the box office. It's basically, it's very similar kind of vibe to the film Superbad. It's about these two girls who, you know, did really, really well in school. They were, it was like the day before high school graduation, and they had like perfect grades, and they never went to party or do anything like that because they were afraid of like messing up their grades, messing up their chance of getting into a good school. But they find out, though, that everyone they, you know, were in school with, they're like asking them where they went to school, you know, where they're going to college, and they're all like going to these really, really good schools as well. And these are these kids that were like always missing school, always partying all the time, and they're like really upset that they weren't partying and they missed out on all these parties. So they have like one day, you know, the one like last final night before the graduation, they're gonna go and have this insane crazy night. They want to get to this crazy party and kind of like do everything that they missed out on throughout all of high school. Like I said, it's a really, really fun movie. I really like that one a lot. The other one I saw was the film Brightburn. You know, it's basically, though, about this couple that end up, you know, their kid. I don't want to ruin too much. The trailer kind of shows some stuff, though, but they basically, though, you know, they get this kid in an interesting way that they got this kid. And essentially, though, after, I think it's after 13 years, or 12 years, this kid, you know, starts, like, showing these weird ways of acting, starts doing these really odd things, and kind of starts to have an attitude, and things around this kid, are, like, bad are starting to happen to him. It kind of has, like, the vibe a little bit to the movie The Prodigy. It's not not the story-wise or anything, but like with this bad kid. And I actually think I like this one more than Prodigy. It was a really, really insane movie. Like I said, don't want to ruin anything that happens. There's a lot of really interesting stuff in it, like some interesting like twists and stuff in it. I really liked it a lot. If you guys have seen, you know, saw either of those ones this past weekend, though, let me know what you guys thought of them or what movies you saw this past weekend if you guys got to see anything.
Into Best Buy we go. Yeah, and they have Greta here as well, but like I said, that one is $22.99 for that one in here, so Walmart definitely has the best price for that. You can price match, though, but it might be difficult to price match because when I was looking on Walmart's site, they didn't actually show Greta at all on there for Blu-ray. They only showed the DVD, so it might be better just to go in person for that. It may be like on like one of their weekly ads or something, but yeah, it was weird. Sometimes Walmart doesn't like list their stuff on the actual website. Other than that, though, I don't see anything else over here, but we'll head over to the section, though, and see if there's anything else over there, though. Yeah, but over here, though, they do have South Park. It seems like they don't have the, I don't see the Blu-ray of that one in here anywhere, though, but that one is $21.99 for that. Also, they re-released Toy Story 1 through 3 today. It has digital copies of all of them. Each of those ones are $24.99 for that, for these ones. Next Tuesday, though, they're releasing them all on 4K. I think there might be a steelbook for one of them. I'm not sure, though, if there's for one or all of them next Tuesday. I'm not 100% sure. And they have a Vigilante here as well. That one's $16.99 for that. This one also released today. I forgot to mention that in Walmart. The Unity of Heroes. That one's $14.99 for that one. But other than that, though, it doesn't. I'm not seeing anything else here different today as far as I can tell.
So anyway though guys, that's all for my DVD Blu-ray Tuesday shopping video today. Like I always say, if you guys enjoy these shopping videos, definitely give this video a thumbs up. Also leave me comments below on what you guys picked up on DVD, Blu-ray, or 4K if you guys picked up anything today. Now stay tuned though for the really cool movie announcement. Like I said, that's going to be first and then followed by a whole ton of brand new DVD and Blu-ray reviews. And before we get to the reviews, I have some really cool news I want to let you guys know about. I just signed on to do a really fun cameo on the upcoming full moon film, Hollyweed Night, Meet the Ouija's. This film is a throwback to the style of films like The Ghoulies, which is so cool because, like, you know, especially Ghoulies 2 was one of my favorites as a kid. I watched that movie so many times, and this is so cool that this is a movie in a throwback style to that with these little creatures and everything in it. But basically, though, this film, Hollyweed Night, Meet the Ouija's, is the first film in the part of a brand new series that Full Moon is doing, series of 10 films called The Deadly 10, and I'll have a link below to the Deadly 10 website. And basically what this is it's going to be 10 different films. This is the first film of the 10 films that they're shooting first. And what it is you go to the website, you guys can sign up on there, which is absolutely free to sign up. There's no, like, charges or anything to sign up to the site. And what it is you guys can watch the entire production of these 10 different films. And Hollyweed Night, like I said, is the first film in the series. And on there, the way it works is, they're going to be having live streams. So there's, like, live streams from the casting sessions of these films. So they have, like, the actors coming in doing the readings. There's live streams showing the special effects, like working on the monsters for the films and the future films as well. And then they have going to have roaming cameras live on set while they're shooting these movies. So that's what's really cool, is you guys can watch the behind the scenes as it's all happening live. And you guys can see, you know, all the, you know, bloopers and outtakes and kind of how they're doing the effects and all that kind of stuff. So it's a really cool thing to be able to watch all that stuff. And there, of course, it's going to be live too the night that I'm there, and I'm gonna be talking more about that as well. And I'll talk about it in the, you know, the DVD Tuesday video that's, like, right before that, letting you guys know. And I'll be posting online on Instagram and all that kind of stuff to let you guys know as well when it's going to be live, when I'll be on there, when they're shooting. But there's gonna be some really cool people as well coming to do cameos in the big party scene of the movie, like Sal and Richard from The Howard Stern Show, Medicated Pete from The Howard Stern Show, Barbara Crompton, who has been in, you know, tons and tons of horror movies, most notably, I would say, like, From Beyond, and of course Reanimator, as well as, like, Mindy Robinson. So lots and lots of people are coming in to do these cameos. It's gonna, you know, in the party scene. It's gonna be a really, really cool movie. So excited to work with Full Moon, because I've been a fan of Full Moon forever. Like, you know, as a kid, like I said, I was watching their early films, like the movies they did before, like Empire Pictures, like The Ghoulies, and of course I love the series that Charles Band had as well, that, you know, the kids series Moonbeam, which I was watching. I think they came out when I was about, like, 6 or 7 years old is when they first started coming out, and they did, like, you know, the Prehysteria series and Remote, which I loved, and Pet Shop. But like I said, I want to let you guys know about this, so definitely head to the link below, you know, to the Deadly 10 you know, website. Like I said, the link is below for that, for you guys can find out how to sign up. But like I said, it's totally free, there's no charge or anything to see all this stuff. And it's a really cool thing if you guys are interested in behind the scenes and just kind of watching the way all these movies are, you know, produced. And it will tell you too when the movies are releasing, because all 10 of them are going to be releasing the same day on their Amazon Prime channel. Like I said, all that kind of stuff will be talked about on the website. But like I said, really excited about this, and I wanted to let you guys know all about this. But now on to the reviews. And the first one I got here is from Shout Factory, and this is one that I watched as a kid. And I remember going to see this one as, like, a birthday party, like a bunch of kids got together for someone's birthday. At first I thought it was, like, for my birthday, and I was like, no, this would not have been my birthday, because when this released, my birthday is in September. So I'm like, no, this was somebody else's party that I saw this at. I remember you used to do that, like, birthday parties at the movies. But this is, you know, Mighty Morphin Power Rangers the movie. And as a kid, though, you know, I always loved the Mighty Morphin Powers, Power Rangers TV series. And this was the movie, you know, version of it, with, you know, them having way more money and, you know, a huge budget to it and everything. And it's a fun movie. I had not watched this movie in so many years, so it's really fun to see this one again. Because, like, I, you know, this came out in, like, 95. I honestly don't think I've seen this maybe since, like, the last time I watched this was maybe, like, 1999 or something. It's been a really long time. So I totally forgot some of this. And this is about, basically, though, about these construction workers who end up unearthing this egg, and it's Ivan Ooze in this egg, and Ivan Ooze is kind of, like, causing all these problems, and he has, like, these ooze-type creatures and everything. And this one, though, the Power Rangers, because of what happens to the one character, you know, I always forget his name. Is it like the one who's in the glass thing? I don't know why I always forget his name. I mix him up, but, you know, he gets like injured and he's dying and they have to figure out how they're going to save him. So, but and because of he got injured, though, the Power Rangers lost their powers. So they have to travel to this other planet to try and figure out how they're going to get the, you know, save. I think it's Zordon, unless I'm mixing it all up, but they basically have to figure out how to save him. And then, you know, to help, you know, figure out if they're going to get their powers back and everything. It's them, you know, fighting things without their powers. It's a really fun movie, though. Like I said, I had not seen this movie in so many years, so really glad this one has a Blu-ray release. I believe soon, I think in a month or so, the sequel, I believe, is coming out as well. But this one has on here, though, feature-wise, a look back on the Mighty Morphin Power Rangers, the movie, which has new interviews on here with the director and some of the stars, as well as the original featurette and a theatrical trailer on this one. The next one here is another one that I had never seen before, and it's called, you know, and this is When a Stranger Calls Back. This is a sequel to When a Stranger Calls that Carol Kane was in, and I think that was in, I think, like 1978, something around then when that came out. And there was her character, Carol Kane's character, was this babysitter who was getting harassed by this guy on the phone. They made a remake of it as well in the early, like, I think, when did that come out, like 2006 or something, a remake of the When a Stranger Calls, which was okay, as I remember. But the original one was a really creepy movie, but she was getting these calls by this, you know, someone just kind of like messing around with her over the phone. And I don't want to ruin what happens, but essentially, though, this one is about this girl who's played by, I never heard her say her name right. It's like Jill Schloen, who is also in Popcorn and in, you know, the Babes in Toyland movie with Drew Barrymore and Keanu Reeves, which is one of those movies that, like, I dream one day will finally come to, like, DVD or Blu-ray. It's only ever been released on VHS, and it's kind of like this forgotten movie, but she was in that movie, and she always kind of, to me, had like, reminded me, like, her look and everything of Winona Ryder. In this one, she really looks like Winona Ryder, and, like, in the beginning of this movie. But this is basically, though, about her character, and she's babysitting these kids at this house. And then, like, you know, she gets, ends up, like, outside of the house, she gets, like, a knock at the door, and there's this guy going, can you help me, my car is broken down, and I need a, can you let me come in and make a phone call? And she, like, doesn't want to let him in, because she's, like, afraid, it's, like, kind of really late, and she doesn't know, there's no, like, peephole in the window, you know, in the door, so she can't see who it is. And this guy is, like, messing with her, and he's, like, going, can you call AAA for me? And then, like, and then she, you know, the phone's dead, so she just pretends like she called, and he's, like, coming back again and going, did you call? I've been out there an hour, they didn't come. And, like, it's like all these problems. And of course, though, she's out there stalking, you know, he's out there stalking her. And then, like, you know, it cuts to, like, him, like, really, like, he's about to come into the house, and then it cuts to, like, years later, and, like, you know, you find out, and this isn't a spoiler or anything, you find out that the kids in the house were never found, and you don't know where they are, and she's kind of trying to, she's in college now, she's trying to, like, kind of get her life together, and she's, like, things seem like they're okay, but then all of a sudden, weird things start to happen in her apartment, and she finds this, like, the clothes, like, one of the clothes that belonged to one of that, the kid that went missing, and, like, it freaks her out again. So she goes to talk to the cops, and that's how Carol Kane's character comes in there as, like, a kind of like a social worker or something like that at the school, at the college, who kind of helps people who have problems and stuff. So she comes in there to kind of help her out. And Charles Durning, who's in the original movie as well, I don't remember the original that well, but I don't remember exactly what happens. I think he was, like, the police investigator. I need to watch the original one again. But I did see it, though, but he comes to kind of help her as well to try and figure out, you know, who this person was, because that person, you know, like, in the beginning of the movie, in the first, like, 15 minutes, was never found. That's, I don't want to say, like I said, don't want to say too much more, but essentially, though, she's getting harassed again, you know, and it's a question, is this guy back? And that's kind of what it is, like, what happened in the first 15 minutes of the movie. But I actually really like this movie. I was looking it up, and it was a movie that aired on Showtime, but it has on here, feature-wise, it has a new 2K scan of it, and has the version of it in widescreen or full screen that you guys can watch, two different versions. It also has an interview on here with the director, as well as interview with Carol Kane and Jill Schoelen as well. And then also has a new scan restoration of the director's original short film, The Sitter, was on here as well. But definitely one, if you guys have not seen, would recommend you guys check it out. And next one here is from Shout Factory Scream Factory line as well. This is the collector's edition here of The Entity. This one also has the reversible artwork, which is the original poster image for this one. This is one that I always really liked. And it's basically, though, about Barbara Hershey's character. And she ends up, like, essentially, it's like a paranormal kind of haunted house movie that's very different, though, because it's all focusing on her character. And the one night in the house, you know, she's in there with her kids and stuff and her older son, and she gets attacked and she gets, like, assaulted, and all these horrible things are happening to her. But, like, there's no one there. She sees nobody, but she thinks maybe she, like, somehow she didn't notice them, or she doesn't know. She's kind of really confused exactly what's happening, but she was totally attacked, and she's, like, screaming, and, like, there's also this really creepy kind of, like, music that they're playing when she's getting attacked and the things are happening to her. It's like this, like, crazy, like weird kind of boom boom, like weird kind of noise. It's really creepy. But it's essentially, though, about her getting attacked, and, you know, and the older son's, like, in the house going, I don't know who did this. I don't, what are you talking about? The doors are all totally locked. No one, I didn't see anybody or hear anybody. I didn't, you know, nothing looks like it was broken. And then, you know, it's basically, though, these things are happening to her, you know, and it's happening to her, like, in a car and other different spots. And it's kind of like, she's trying to figure out, like, is she going crazy? And she's going to, like, this school, and they're doing, like, these studies on her and trying to figure out exactly what's happening to her and, like, why she's having these things happen to her. And it's, like, trying to figure out, like I said, if these are things that she's imagining or if there's some kind of a spirit that's, like, coming after her, and why are these horrible things happening to her, and why are they doing this to her, and, like, what can she do to, you know, to get this to stop? Like I said, it's a very creepy and very original, different movie here. This has on here, though, a whole bunch of different features. It has interviews on here with Barbara Hershey. It has on here an interview with the composer, interview with the editor, a commentary track on this one. It has on here, though, the Entity Files, which includes an interview with a parapsychologist, as well as a theatrical trailer and a still gallery. But if you guys have not seen this one I would definitely recommend you guys check out. This is another one here. This is a Hammer horror film called Frankenstein Created Woman. And this is another one that I always really like. This is one of, like, my favorite, or one of my top Hammer horror films. I just like this one because it was, like, a really different kind of a Frankenstein movie, where it was not like Frankenstein who was going and, like, you know, like, creating the monster with, like, different body parts and that kind of stuff. It was, like, a really different kind of thing because, you know, it's about Peter Cushing's character, who's, you know, Frankenstein. He has, like, his another doctor who's working with him, and then it's, like, this the assistant who's there as well. And essentially, though, what Peter Cushing's character is doing is trying to figure out how to, like, trap the soul, or if the soul of somebody, if they died, and, like, he wants to figure out how to, like, take their soul, somebody who just recently died, and he's, like, doing all these weird things about trying to see how long it stays alive, and he can, like, capture it and keep it alive, the soul itself, because he wants to put the soul into another body so, like, they can live on in another body, someone who's about to die or someone who just died. But what ends up happening in this, though, I don't want to ruin too much, but essentially, though, it's about the assistant's body being transferred into his girlfriend, because, you know, and that's essentially what it is, because his girlfriend, you know, basically, though, the assistant, you know, had died because of a certain thing that he did. He was framed for something, and then the girlfriend, though, was upset about that, and, you know, she killed herself because of it, and he puts, you know, the doctor puts the assistant's soul into her body, and then it's kind of like, what happens from there. But it's a really, really, like I said, very interesting movie. This has on here, though, a brand new 2K scan for the original film elements on here. Looks really, really good. Has a commentary track on here with film historians on this one, and it has a commentary track on here with some of the actors, as well as a World of Hammer Horror episode, the Curse of Frankenstein, the Hammer Glamour documentary, theatrical trailers, TV spots, and a still gallery on this one. Now, the next one here is from Lionsgate. It's a movie that stars Ethan Hawke and Dane DeHaan, called The Kid. And this is, you know, I actually really like this movie, and it's directed by Vincent D'Onofrio, you know, who he acts in this movie as well. But, you know, when I always think of him, I think of him from, you know, Full Metal Jacket, and then, like, Men in Black. Those are the ones I always think of him from. But, you know, he directed this one. I don't know if he directed a lot of other things as well, but he did a really good job on this. And it was a, because I, you know, when it came to Billy the Kid, I only, like, knew of Billy the Kid. Like, I knew, like, not much about him, though. I only really knew, like, of him, honestly, from Bill and Ted's Excellent Adventure. And that really was kind of like, you know, you can't really trust anything you heard in that one, because they kind of changed things around a little bit, the characters, and made him, like, goofy and everything. So don't really follow that as, like, the true history, you know. But that, you know, this one here is basically, though, about you know, Billy the Kid's character and his, like, gang of outlaws, who is kind of the really young guy who is kind of, like, wanted by the police and everything, and Ethan Hawke's character is trying to track him down. There's a big bounty on, Dane DeHaan's character who plays Billy the Kid, and he's trying to find him and everything, and, Ethan Hawke's character is all about, like, if you killed somebody or you did something like that, you would be hanged and all that kind of stuff. He's really, like, a cop who's, who's really to the books and all that kind of stuff, or a sheriff who's really to the books with all that kind of things. And essentially, though, this is about these two kids who are on the run because the bad guy in this movie is played by Chris Pratt. And Chris Pratt did a really good job playing this really bad, like, mean guy. Like, a really different role for him. I thought he did a really good job. Like, I'd love to see him do more, like, roles like that when he plays, like, a mean guy. Because, you always think of him from, like, Guardians of the Galaxy and kind of playing nice guys and stuff like that. But I'd never seen him do something like this, playing this, like, horrific, horrible guy. But he basically, though, these two kids in the beginning of this movie are, like, their mother is being attacked by their drunk, father who's, like, abusive and everything. And they end up, killing the father to stop them from killing the mother, but the mother dies, and Chris Pratt plays the brother of the father that they ended up killing, and he's, like, angry and, like, profusely crazy about that, and both the kids run off and are kind of on the run, and he's, like, trying to find them throughout this movie and figure out where they are, and these kids end up getting linked up with Dane DeHaan's character, who's hiding out in this kind of shack, like I said, he's Billy the Kid, and they're there hiding out. And, Ethan Hawke comes to find them, and they kind of go off with them because, Ethan Hawke wants to take Billy the Kid in to go to pay for his crimes and go to the court and all that kind of stuff. These kids come along, and it's essentially, though, about, like, what happens to the kids and, what the journey that they go on. But highly recommend you guys check this out. I really thought this was a good, a pretty good movie here. This has on here, though, a making of on this one. Next one here is from Lionsgate as well, and this is also an A24 release. This is a movie that stars Julianne Moore and John Turturro, who was from, like, The Big Lebowski, and he was recently, a couple years ago, he was on the show called The Night Of, which I really love that show. This is called Gloria Bell. This is basically, though, about Gloria, about Julianne Moore's character, who basically, though, she has, like, a regular kind of job. She's been divorced for a number of years from her husband, and she kind of is just, like, just sort of does, like, normal kind of things and isn't super, she's kind of, like, not really had any other big relationships and not really kind of gotten to the point where she's kind of given up on really dating, and she's not doing too much, but she kind of goes out at night and kind of parties, like, goes to these clubs and dances and, like, stuff like that. But one night, though, and that's kind of her way of kind of getting out and doing something, but one night when she goes to do this, she ends up meeting John Turturro's character, and they kind of, like, start just talking to each other and, like, end up having this hookup. And they kind of start to really like each other, and it's sort of about Julianne Moore's character trying to, as older now and, like, kind of out of dating and all that, seeing what it's like to date now and kind of going through the whole thing and kind of, like, being really rusty on dating and, like, not sure how she's going to tell her kids about this and not sure, like, kind of if she's serious about this. And it's the whole thing is actually a really, really well done character piece here. Really great performances on this one. This has on here a making of, as well as a commentary track on here with the director. The next one here is from Lionsgate as well, and this is the last Madea film that there will be. I do wonder if maybe, like, 10 years from now, Madea will come back again, or maybe, like, I kind of hope that maybe, like, there won't be, like, Madea movies. If Tyler Perry doesn't want to do Madea movies per se, like, where, like, Madea's the star, maybe Madea will make, like, 1-minute cameos every so often in movies or something. Like, I don't know. I just hope Madea's not gone forever, because I really like the character, honestly. And this is Tyler Perry's A Madea Family Funeral. And this one here is about this family, Madea's family. Someone in the family had died, and they're all coming together for the funeral. And the thing that I like about the Madea movies, it's kind of funny, though, is, like, Madea says, like, the craziest things, like, the most crazy, and, like, her brother Joe and everything, like, they're saying, like, these crazy things and around the family and these, like, really ridiculous stuff. And, like, they're kind of all talking, and, like, the family, like, ignores everything. And in a weird way, like, they don't react react to it or notice it. It's almost like Medea's like just talking to herself or something. Like the way, I don't know, it's something really funny about it. It's like a lot of the movies are like that, especially this one, where like they're saying all this crazy stuff and the family is just like having this heavy drama, like this heavy drama about the one that died and everything, and about like the funeral, and that there's like some, the one in the family, they think there might be cheating going on and everything. And Medea's just saying these crazy things back to her brother Joe, and they're arguing, and no one in the family is really like saying much to what they're saying. But this is just a really, really fun movie. I love the Medea series, and I like I said, it's sad that there won't be any more Medea films, but I still like all the other movies that Tyler Perry's done, like Acrimony recently, I really liked as well, which was like a real heavy like drama film, which I thought he did a good job on that one. And this one has on here, though, deleted scenes, outtakes, some featurettes on here, like Medea's tips for attending a funeral, and then a making of on here, and then looking back on Medea. But like I said, if you guys are a fan of the Medea movies, definitely I would recommend checking this out. This one here, as well, as from Lionsgate, and this one is stars Hilary Duff, and this is The Haunting of Sharon Tate. This is like the it's a kind of a horror take on what happened to Sharon Tate, and it's, you know, because Sharon Tate was, you know, married to Roman Polanski, and you know, her and her friends were killed by, you know, Charles Manson like sent the people to kill her, you know, her, and it was like a horrible, horrible thing that happened. And this is basically, though, about the like the 3 nights leading up to her murder. And it's kind of like I said, it's done in a horror aspect because, you know, Sharon Tate, who's played by Hilary Duff in the film, she's kind of having these, like, bad dreams. And, like, they play this one game and they get, like, almost like this kind of, like, Ouija board kind of, sort of a kind of game like that, where it's, like, this rolling ball thing. And it kind of says that things are not going to go well when they're playing it. So, like, she's getting, like, these warnings that things are not going to go well. And they're also outside of the house, outside of her house. You know, it's, like, a gated house where people shouldn't be in the backyard and stuff. They're, like, hearing people out there, and people are ringing the doorbell and all this kind of stuff, and she's having bad dreams, like premonitions of what could happen. It's a definitely a very interesting, different take on the whole, you know, behind her murder and like what led up to it. And like I said, it's done in like a horror kind of, you know, aspect of like her with the premonitions and everything. But this has on here, though, a commentary track on here with the writer and director, as well as a featurette on this one. And next one I got here is from Warner Brothers, who sent out a free copy of this one to let you guys know that this is available. This here is Isn't It Romantic, which stars Rebel Wilson. This is basically, though, about Rebel Wilson's character, who's this architect who is like kind of the one who's like not really super popular at work, and they kind of like don't listen to all of her ideas and everything. And the one day she's out getting coffee and everything and donuts, and she ends up like on the subway. This guy, you know, tries to rob her, and she ends up running away from him and bumping her head real hard on the subway, in this beam in the subway, and then wakes up in the hospital. And when she wakes up in there, though, it's kind of like this weird thing, though, because everything seems different. Like, New York City seems, like, super put together and really beautiful. And then, like, her room at the hospital is, like, really amazing. She gets back to her house. She, like, is in this, like, mansion apartment with all these nice clothes and shoes and all kinds of stuff. Like, really fancy things. And, like, Liam Hemsworth's character is, like, hitting on her. And she's like, whoa, how's somebody like this hitting on me? What's going on here? And what happened, though, is she's basically trapped in a romantic PG-13 movie. So, like, you know, she's even making jokes about this, so she can't say bad words. It's like gets edited out and in the world and everything, and it's everything is real perfect, and she's kind of there trying to figure out what's going on and what she's going to do. And she kind of likes it a little bit, this world, but at the same time, it's like gets really old. And it's like, you know, and it's also funny too with like Liam Hemsworth's character like coming after her and like, you know, being obsessed with her and like bothering her all the time. And she works with Adam Devine's character, who is kind of like the goofy guy at, you know, at work. But I don't know, it's a really fun movie. It's the director of this also directed the movie The Final Girls, which I really like that one as well, which is a horror movie when people got trapped in the horror movie. This one has on here, though, deleted scenes, and then a featurette on here about the dance scene in this movie. And the next one here is from Warner Bros. As well. They sent a free copy of this one as well to let you guys know that this one was available. And this is A Star Is Born, the special encore edition here. This includes the Blu-ray, the DVD, and the digital copy of the film. This is the extended version, which is about 12 minutes longer of the movie. This has in here, though, nearly 12 minutes of extended music performances, intimate jam sessions with Jackson and Allie, as well as new scenes in this one. So this one, you know, had like a limited run, this longer version version of the film. I believe it was a week long that it lasted in theaters. It was a really limited run of this. So really glad that they released this one on Blu-ray. And if you guys don't know the film, though, this is a remake of the film that was from the 70s with Barbara Streisand and, you know, Kris Kristofferson. And that one was actually a remake of a film that I know Judy Garland was on. I never saw the original one. But basically, though, if you guys don't know this film, though, it's about Bradley Cooper's character, who's the star, who's really a hugely popular, successful music star, but he's having some alcohol problems, and he's kind of like having some problems in his life, but he like goes one night drinking at this bar and ends up seeing Lady Gaga's character performing on stage, and he becomes like, you know, cannot believe how amazing her voice is, and you know, he starts talking to her, and he like starts to really like her and saying, you know, he wants to help her and help her get her music out there and help make her a star. And that's essentially what it does. It's about their relationship and him like helping her. And it's kind of like what ends up happening when like her character starts to become very successful, and then like sort of like what happens to him. But it's a really, really well done, well acted movie. Really like this one a lot. Like I said, one thing you guys know about the extended cut of this one, this one comes out next Tuesday. And the next one here is from Warner Bros. As well. They sent over a free copy of this one as well to let you guys know that this one was available. This is one I was really excited about when I heard this one was releasing on Blu-ray. And this is the new Scooby-Doo movies, the Almost Complete Collection. These are ones that I remember watching so many times as a kid. I absolutely love these movies. And these were what they were Scooby-Doo and the gang like helping like the celebrity guest stars on like mysteries or something that was happening to them, like they were haunted by ghosts and stuff like that. And there's like characters on here like Scooby-Doo with the Harlem Globetrotters and Dick Van Dyke, the Three Stooges. The Three Stooges was the one I remember really, really loving that movie. Also, Don Knotts, Lauren Hardy, Sonny and Cher, this is the Almost Complete Collection because there was a couple of the ones where like the characters were owned by a different company. So that some of the ones that weren't on here were like Scooby-Doo with the Addams Family. I don't know any of the other ones, but I know the Addams Family is for sure was one of the ones that wasn't in this set. This has on here, though, some features that has like the Hanna-Barbera Kennel Club Roast Scooby-Doo, Uptown with Scooby-Doo and the Harlem Globetrotters, Girls Rock, which is a spotlight on Daphne and Velma. I'll show you guys a little look inside. It has like a little episode guide which tells you which are the special guest stars, and it's a two-disc Blu-ray set here, but really fun films here. I always loved watching these ones as a kid. They also sent over the DVD of this one, because they released this set on DVD in the past, but there were some of the movies that were not on that set that they released, and this one here is the best of the new Scooby-Doo movies, the lost episodes. So this has some of the ones on a DVD version that were, you know, released on DVD in the past, but, you know, these are the ones that were not on that set, like some of the ones that they didn't have on the past release of the Scooby-Doo movie set. And the next one here is from Warner Brothers as well. They sent over a free copy of this one as well for me to let you guys know that this one is available. And this one here is The Venture Bros, the complete seventh season here on DVD. There's also a Blu-ray release of this one as well. This is a show that I've seen episodes of this, you know, here and there throughout the years. It's on since, I believe it started in 2003. It's kind of a superhero kind of sort of parody show. It's also like parodying Johnny Quest as well. This is like one of the early Adult Swim shows that I remember watching. Like I said, I want you guys to know that this one was available if you guys were a fan of the show on DVD and Blu-ray, and here's a little look inside. It has really cool artwork on this one. Love the images on this one, and here's a look inside the discs. Like I said, just want you guys to know that this one is available if you guys are a fan of the Venture Bros. The next one here is from Paramount, and this is Tom Clancy's Jack Ryan, the complete first season here on Blu-ray. And this is one I was really interested in seeing. This is a show that, you know, is an Amazon Prime original show, and you know, it comes to Jack Ryan series, though. I've watched all the Jack Ryan films, you know, and Paramount released them in a box set a couple months back on 4K, and I believe there's a Blu-ray box set as well. But they're really cool movies. This one, though, is John Krasinski's playing Jack Ryan, and this is like a different version of him because his character is kind of like, has like a desk job, and he just like does like analysis work, looking at like bank transfers and money kind of stuff, and he notices that there's some, like a lot of money being like transferred in this, in like he's kind of like this one big account, and he thinks that it could be like some like terrorist kind of activity or something, and he kind of tells his boss, and the one boss who just came working there, he's like new, and he's like, oh, doesn't really want to, you know, that mess with anything there, because he just got there and he just like got kind of demoted, and he's like afraid of saying too much because he could like get to, you know, fired from where he's at now. But like he kind of goes over the new boss's head and tells someone above about what he's noticing about this money and buying these weapons and buying these things. And of course they investigate it, and Jack Ryan kind of goes there to kind of like talk to the people that are like that, because they arrest the guy that they think is like, you know, in charge of all that stuff. And it's essentially though about him trying to stop something bad that he believes is going to happen and stop this bad guy. And it's kind of them throughout the show going and trying to find him, and they're having all kind of other little problems as well that they're discovering. It's kind of Jack Ryan, the character, starting to like go from, you know, because originally his, you know, in this one though his character was in war, and then like when he came back from war he just had this desk job. But then, you know, in the Jack Ryan films it's kind of this guy who's going around, you know, going after all these people and everything. This one is right when he like he's starting to do these kind of things. So like throughout the show he starts doing more and more stuff out there and going after people and everything. But I actually really like this show. I thought this was actually really well done. This has on here though, feature wise it has deleted scenes. And the next one here is from Paramount as well, and this is South Park, the complete 22nd season on Blu-ray. This is one of those things, it's like crazy to think that this has now been on for 22 seasons. I've actually watched this show since the very beginning when this started. This started right when I was going into the 6th grade, and I remember like all the stuff with this, like, you know, when I first discovered this show, like I think I discovered it like the day before I went to school. And I remember like talking about this show all the time and like being so obsessed with this in the very beginning. I remember when the first movie came out and like I really wanted to see it in theaters, but I was like not allowed to see it. You know, and I remember like, you know, when it came to DVD, I talked my parents into finally letting me watch the, you know, because it was like the R-rated version of it, uncensored. So I remember all this stuff with this show. And it's really fun too. This one has like Mr. Hankey comes back. Mr. Hankey the Christmas Pooh. Like that was a character that I always loved. I don't know, I feel like this show too, you know, they always do such an amazing job being so topical, because like they animate this show, you know, the week before that it airs, which is like, and they've done a documentary on that, how they do it, and like up until the air date, like right before it airs, they're changing things and adding things, and they're so topical on like certain subjects that are going on or something that happened in the news the week before. Like, I don't know, it's just amazing the way that they put this show together. And it's, I feel like too, nowadays though, they kind of have more episodes to kind of like, connect together more with like the plots and stuff than they did in the past, because in the past they were kind of more like standalone episodes. But this one, like now, they kind of connect a lot more with characters, and certain characters come back from past seasons and they have like big story arcs and stuff that continue on. But still, this is a show that I've always really liked, and like so glad that the show continues on. And like, you know, if you guys are a fan of this show, like I said, want to let you guys know that this one is available. And also feature wise though, that's one thing I always think is cool, they always have on these mini commentaries with Matt Stone and Trey Parker, you know, talking about the mini commentaries on the episodes, as well as deleted scenes on this one. The next one here is from Sony. This one here is an interesting movie, really, really cool animation style. It's called Reuben Brandt Collector. And this one here is basically, though, about this guy who has, he's having all these like horrible dreams about like artwork, like these famous photos and things like that are like attacking him in his dreams, and they're kind of making him paranoid. And like I said, it has like all the stuff in here is like real like classic, you know, known photos, the way that everything is animated and the look to everything. It has a really amazing animation style to this. But essentially though, he's like having these horrible dreams, and then like some of the artwork is like getting like stolen, and it's like it has stuff to do with him, like people that he knows are involved in this. And it's kind of like this stealing this art and everything while he's still having these horrible dreams. It's a little hard to explain, but if you guys are a fan of animation, like fans of really, really trippy animation and like amazing, like just like amazing drawings, and like the way that this is like animated and put together, this is one I definitely would recommend you guys check out. Just like such a cool look. Now the next one's here, the next bunch are all from Movie Zing, and this one here is our Universal release. This is a movie that stars Tom Selleck, which I had never seen before, and I really love this movie. This is such a fun movie called Mr. Baseball. And like I said, this is one I never heard of before. I never knew anything about this one. I don't know how I totally like missed this movie and never heard anything about it at all. It's about Tom Selleck's character, who's this baseball player who's in the major leagues. He's like really, you know, was very popular, but you know, throughout the years his game hasn't been as good, and he's kind of like about to be like fired from the team because they're bringing this other guy who's much better, and he's kind of just not really doing too well anymore and kind of not really practicing or putting much effort in. And what ends up happening, though, is he ends up getting traded and he goes to a team in Japan. And he's kind of there, you know, and he kind of takes it as kind of like he doesn't really care when he goes. He's not really putting any effort into it. And it's kind of him with like the culture shock of how different things are, how different the game is played, and like how the coach is kind of like yelling at him. And like he's speaking Japanese, so he has like an interpreter that having to help interpret everything. And the interpreter is like always interpreting things very different. So every time Tom Selleck's character says something like kind of like against the coach, he just like the interpreter makes it like he's just agreeing like, yeah, that sounds good. And it's kind of all these problems, and Tom Selleck's character meets this girl there who he's trying to, you know, date and everything. It's just a really, really fun movie. This is one, like I said, highly recommend you guys check this out. I really love this movie. Let me know what you guys thought of this one if you guys had seen this one before. And the next one here is from Universal as well, and this is The Flintstones and Viva Rock Vegas. Now this one is not, you know, this one's the sequel to the Flintstones movie, but this is technically actually the prequel. Because this, you know, it's a different cast and everything in this one. This has you know, Stephen Baldwin in here as Barney, and then, you know, Fred Flintstone is played by Mark Addy. You know, Mark Addy was, I always think of him from, you know, the Full Monty, and this one is, and then it's like in here, it's, Jane Krasowski plays Betty, and then Wilma is played by Christian Johnston. And it's basically, though, about how, you know, they all meet and kind of, like, start dating and everything. And it's kind of about them going to Viva Rock Vegas, which is, like, a prehistoric version, like, caveman time version of Vegas. It's actually a really fun movie. Like I said, it's not as fun as the original Flintstones movie, which I always really love that one. I watched that one so many times. But this one's still really cool. This one now, though, has a Blu-ray release. But on here, though, it has a spotlight on location, the making of Flintstones and Viva Rock Vegas. And this one here is, like I said, these ones are all from Movie Zing, but this is a Lionsgate release. And this is the Burn on Demand Blu-ray release of the film by Gaspar Noel, Climax. Like I said, this one is a Burn on Demand Blu-ray, but really glad there is a Blu-ray of this. And this is, you know, a really, really trippy movie. It's all about this this dance troupe who is all practicing, you know, for like this show, and it's kind of them all in this kind of small space, you know, practicing. They're kind of like have like food out and they're kind of partying as well. And what ends up happening, though, is someone puts, you know, spikes the drink, the punch with this LSD. And it's essentially, though, about, you know, them drinking this, you know, and then, like, it kind of the night goes into this downward crazy spiral of these dancers going, like, totally, absolutely, insanely crazy. There is amazing dance sequences in this. Like, they're so well choreographed. Sophie Boutella is, like, the star of the film, like, headlining this dance troupe and, like helping them with all the practice and everything. And like they just do an amazing job in here with this dancing. And also I love the music in this. It's like it's really great music like set to these scenes. It's like a DJ character, and there's some cool techniques in here too. Like they do some of it like these really, really long takes where it's just like, you know, especially some of the big dance scenes, which is like how in the world do they do that and choreograph all these camera moves with no edits. But this is one I highly recommend you guys check out. It's an absolute must watch. This has on here though a making of on here, but just such a great movie, all about going like this night going crazy. And the beginning of the movie too, they have like this TV screen when the dancers are like getting interviewed, talking about like their dreams and aspirations and everything. And like on the side there's all these VHS tapes, and definitely check the tapes because there's stuff like Suspiria and a bunch of different movies that all kind of, you know, key into this movie, like what kind of movie you're in for. The next one here is from Movie Zing as well, and this is a Freestyle release from Freestyle digital releasing, I believe it is. And this is a movie called Berserk, which stars Nick Cannon and Ray's Wakefield, who also directed this movie. You know, I always think of Ray's Wakefield from, you know, playing the Polite Stranger, I believe it is, from, you know, the first Purge film, which he was so good in that. And this movie, you know, I was glad to see Nick Cannon again acting in a movie, because Nick Cannon's done more hosting stuff in the last few years. But, like, years back, he was in, like, on All That and Drumline and Undercover Classmen and stuff. Like, this is his first, like, acting movie. I mean, he's, like, the star of this, too. I've seen it in a long time. But this is basically, though, about, you know, Ray's Wakefield, his character, is friends with Nick Cannon. Nick Cannon's character in this is, like, playing this kind of really popular kind of star who's been in a bunch of different movies, and both of them have been friends for a while, and Ray's Wakefield's character is, like, not very successful, not having a lot of luck. He just, in the beginning of this movie, got fired by his agent because he's not booking any work or anything. And he says, oh, I'm trying to work on this script and trying to get this done. So both of, you know, Nick Cannon and both the characters are both coming together at, you know, Nick Cannon's character's house to work on this script to try and get it done. So they, because, like, the agent that just fired Ray's Wakefield's character is like, well, if you get this script done, you can get it to me. Well, maybe we'll do it, you know, but you just told me about the script for years and we're not having you're not getting it done and you're not booking any work or any and acting or anything. So he's like desperate to try and get this done, and Nick Cannon's kind of talking to him about the scene and saying, you know, you always are so particular about these scenes and we can't move past it, and you know, we've never really experienced anything, any real terror in our lives or anything. And right when that happens though, like you know, something really terrible does happen, because like one character, this one guy comes into the house and that Ray's Wakefield's character thinks it's like an intruder, because Nick Cannon's talking about how he's like stalkers around and everything. And basically though, something happens to the guy, and that's when the whole night becomes insane and becomes this night from hell of all sorts of problems. It's kind of got a movie has like a very bad things dark comedy vibe to this one. I actually really like this movie. I thought Nick Cannon as well did a really good job in this movie, and a really different kind of like role for him as well. Like, I guess I definitely hope he does more acting again, because like, you know, I thought he did a really good job. This one here is from, from, what was the company that did this one? But this was from Movie Zing as well, who sent this, but it's a Gunpowder and Sky release, and it's a movie that stars Elizabeth Moss, Cara Delevingne is in this one, Dan Stevens, who's, you know, in The Guest, Ashley Benson's in here, Eric Stoltz, Amber Heard, and this is a movie that stars, Elizabeth Moss, you know, who's most recently, you know, she's in The Handmaid's Tale and most recently in the film Us, called Her Smell. It's basically, though, about Elizabeth Moss's character, who's in this band, and she was someone who was, like, very successful in this band, but she's kind of like things are falling apart around her, and she's like her character is really drinking, and she's not like, you know, taking care of herself, and they're not really doing very well with their music because of her drinking and because of what's happening, and it's like this big downward kind of spiral for her, and it's kind of like all the stuff that she's going through and all the stuff that she's going through with the group, and they're trying to kind of get her together, and like it's kind of like trying to figure out like what they're going to do to kind of like, you know, sort of, because she has this kid too that she's like sort of neglecting a little bit because of the way she's acting, and she's acting really crazy and like not being serious about the music and not really putting the correct, you know, effort into things. But it's actually a really well done character piece here. This one has on here though a commentary track on here with the director. And the next two ones here are both from ViaVision. Both these ones are Australian releases. Now both of these ones are region free as well, so you guys can watch these ones no problem in any US DVD or Blu-ray player. You don't have to have any special player or anything like that to play these ones, so these will play no problem in any U.S. player. But this one here is the complete first season here of Good Girls. This is a show that I've heard a lot of really, really good things about, so I was really looking forward to watching this one. It's actually a really fun show. It stars Christina Hendricks, Mae Whiteman, and Retta. Mae Whiteman, you know, is from The Duff, and, you know, she's done lots and lots of stuff. Does lots of voice work. Christina Hendricks, you know, of course, was from Mad Men, and, you know, The Strangers Pray at Night, and lots of other things as well. But basically, though, it's, you know, Mae Whiteman and Christina Hendricks characters, who are both sisters, and their friend, you know, played by Retta. And, you know, she's like their best friend, and all of them are having, you know, major financial problems. Like, Greta's character's daughter is, like, really sick and needs money for these experimental drugs, you know, to try and help her get better. You know, Mae Whiteman's character is, like, going through, like, recently was divorced, and her, you know, ex-husband wants to get custody of their daughter, so she has to, like, have all this money for these legal fees to fight all what's going on. And, you know, Christina Hendricks' character, her husband, you know, was cheating on her, and, like, basically use all this money. Her husband was played by Matthew Lillard, and, you know, he was, like, sunk all this money into these bad deals and was basically going broke. So all of them team up together and plan on robbing the one where the one character works at the market. But they end up robbing this, and, you know, it goes well at first, but then it ends up turning out like it becomes, like, in the first episode, they get found out, and they find out too, because they ended up getting way more money than they should have. It was like $500,000, and it turns out that, like, there was, like, these bad people there that, you know, had their money there, and there's like this whole operation, and they kind of come after both all these girls and say, you got to get the money back. So it's kind of like them trying to figure out what they're going to do and if they're going to have to go and rob somebody else to try and get the money back to get these people to stop coming after them. So it's a huge nightmare, but it's a really, really fun show. You know, highly recommend you guys check this one out. The first season here is 10 episodes here, and this is a three-disc set. This one here is from ViaVision as well. This one is region-free as well, so you can play this one no problem in any U.S. player. And this is the complete first season here of the show that airs on Sci-Fi Happy. This is another one. This is from one of the directors of, you know, of both the Crank films. And this is based on a graphic novel. This is basically, though, about this guy who was a cop, and now he's like, he's an ex-cop, and now he's a hitman. And he was out, like, going after this guy, and he ended up getting, you know, shot, and he, you know, had died, and he got brought back to life on this, you know, on the gurney and then the back of the ambulance. And this, what ends up happening, though, is this imaginary friend character of this girl who ended up, you know, getting kidnapped. The imaginary friend character, who's like this horse kind of unicorn character, is trying to find somebody to try and, like, get help to help, you know, the girl that was kidnapped. And of course, this unicorn character comes to this guy who was just revived. So he's like seeing this unicorn and is like telling him, you need to help this girl. And there's also way more connection to him and this girl. So I don't want to ruin too much of what happens with this, but it's kind of him going and trying to, like, find this girl, and also, like, they're like teaming up together to come after other people as well. But this is a really wacky, crazy, over the top show here. Really fun show. And this one here is a two disc set here of all 8 episodes of the season here. And next one here is from ITN Distribution, and this one I just want you guys to know is available. I've talked about this one a little bit in the past. I also showed this one in Walmart, which I believe it's still available in Walmarts as well. It's also, though, of course, on Amazon, all that kind of stuff as well. It's a movie here called Tooth Fairy. It's basically about this farm community getting, like, terrorized by this evil Tooth Fairy, and there was, like, urban legends of it in the past and everything as well about this Tooth Fairy character. But it's a really cool, creepy Tooth Fairy movie, like evil Tooth Fairy film. But the really cool thing about this is the one character is, like, researching about the Tooth Fairy, trying to look into it and everything, and they're, like, looking on this website. It's like about, like, a Tooth Fairy expert kind of site, and they watch a YouTube video, and it's me in there talking about the legend of the Tooth Fairy and, like, my take on the whole thing and everything. So it's really cool, so you guys can see me in this film talking about the Tooth Fairy and the legend of the Tooth Fairy and all that kind of stuff. But on here, though, it has a behind the scenes on the Tooth Fairy as well. Like I said, really cool one here. If you guys are a fan of, like, creepy Tooth Fairy films, definitely check that out. And also, you guys can see me in there as well. And the last one here is from Artsploitation Films. This is a pulp noir style film here called Rondo. This is a movie about this guy who, he's a poor, you know, a war veteran who, like, came back from the war, and he's kind of having problems, like, adapting to life and everything. And, like, he goes to talk to his therapist, and the therapist is saying, like, you know, you should go out there and, like, you know, go sleep with people, sleep with women, get, like, you know, kind of, like, go with all these. She's, like, giving all these kind of, like, advice, and gives him this address to go to with, like, this password, you know, to go to this place. And then he goes there, and it's this weird type of situation where it's, like, this group of these guys there, and, like, this one's wife, and saying you could sleep with the wife. And essentially, though, he goes in there, and, like, he's kind of, like, not sure about all this whole thing, and he sees the one guy that goes in there through the one window because he's outside, not sure what to do, and he sees this one guy getting killed. And essentially, though, he runs off from the whole thing, and it's kind of about, like, these characters kind of coming after him, and then him, like, discovering more and more about, like, the weird go-ons about this group and this place that he went, and the terrible bad stuff going on. It was actually a pretty interesting movie, like a really, like I said, it's got a pulp noir kind of style to this movie. This has on here, though, a director's commentary, deleted scenes, a selected music commentaries with composer on this one, as well as the artwork of Rondo, poster art and lobby cards set to music on this one as well. But anyway, though, guys, that's all for the review portion of this video. Thanks again for watching and subscribing. Like I said as well, be sure to check out the Deadly 10 website too, to, you know, the sign up. Like I said, the link will be below for that, where you guys can find out more about how to, you know, watch all the stuff about the Deadly 10 series. Anyway, though, guys, thanks again for watching and subscribing, and I'll see you guys.